Yeah, so I'd like to welcome everyone to the first meeting of the joint Columbia-CUNY-NYU Number Theory Seminar. And our speaker today is Eun Hye Lee. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly.
Okay.
And she will talk about subconvexity of Shintani Zeta functions.
Well, good evening, and thank you for the kind introduction. I'm honored to open this semester's number theory seminar. Well, so this semester I've been teaching in person, so I haven't been using Zoom all that much. And I didn't realize that I'm not able to see any of the videos, even including myself. So I'm not really sure what's gonna happen with the, you know, videos and stuff. So if you have anything to talk to me, it probably is best if you could just, you know, unmute yourself and talk to me. Otherwise, I probably won't be able to see any of of the things going on. All right. Well, I'm very glad to have an opportunity to talk to you, even though it is online. And I still hope we can talk to one another in real personal world very soon. So today I'll be talking about the subconvexity of the Shintani Zeta function based on a project I did with Robert Huff. Before I say anything new and fancy, I first would like to carefully explain what the problem is and which object we'll be dealing with, which may not be new, but is definitely fancy with a lot of rich history. So I'm sure a lot of you are already familiar with the field of research, but just to make sure that everyone is on the same page, let me still go over some of the definitions as well. So I would like to start by explaining about the subconvexity problem. In the theory of zeta and L function, this subconvexity problem is one of the central interests. For example, if you look at the AIMS website, there's a page with open problems in all different fields of mathematics. And under the analytic number theory part, there is a whole section devoted to the subconvexity, and it has been studied actively for over a century now. What this problem asks for is to prove some non-trivial upper bounds, as opposed to what is called the convex bound, trivial bound, for the L functions on the critical line. So the trivial convexity estimate is obtained by interpolating between the domains of absolute convergence of the Dirichlet series using the functional equation. And this subconvexity problem is asking for a power saving estimate for the function on the critical line compared to the convexity estimate. And the very end final goal of this problem is to prove the Lindelof hypothesis, which I'll explain in a few slides. So in order to get there, let me first give a concrete example, the Riemann zeta function. As all of you know, the Riemann zeta function is a function of a complex variable S, and it continues analytically, and it is written in this form. Right? And it converges where the real part of S is greater than one. Well, that's all very well known. Well, there are a few nice properties that are also well known, and I named just a few of them. First of all, it can be written as Euler product. This is great since when we have to deal with the Riemann zeta function, oftentimes we only look at the Euler factors to tackle it. So this gives a nice way of rescaling the problems into the problems of prime. Another property that is well known is that this function has trivial zeros. Add negative even integers, negative 2, 4, and so on. While these are called trivial zeros, then there are non-trivial zeros, which lie in the critical strip, where the real part of S is in between 0 and 1. In 1914, Hardy proved that there are infinitely many zeros in on the critical line, which is the midline in the critical strip, where the real part is 1/2. The grand Riemann hypothesis suggests that these must be all the non-trivial zeros, but unfortunately no one is able to do it so far. And the last but not least, the Riemann zeta function has a functional equation relating zeta s with zeta 1 minus s and relating involving some gamma factors and stuff. Well, this plays a key role to continue the Riemann zeta function analytically. So then this Riemann zeta function satisfies the fragment Lindelof principle, which is this basically. So for zeta of s plus it, it is bounded by t to the power 1/2 times 1 minus sigma plus epsilon. And the, but people are not satisfied this, and we wish for better, and by better, I mean sharper bounds. And that will mean to get this constant right here, 1/2, or 1/4 if you consider sigma to be 1/2, then this is gonna be 1/4, right? Than what it is right now. So a century ago in 1921, Hardy and Littlewood obtained this classical estimate. So getting this 1/2 to 1/3. And then a major breakthrough happened in 2005 by Merton Huxley, by getting 1/4 to down to 32 over 205. And the best known so far, if I'm not missing anything new, is the result obtained by Jean Bergen in 2016, which gets down to 13 over 84. Okay, so far we've seen what the subconvexity problem is and the known results for the Riemann zeta function and stuff, but I still haven't quite told you what the goal of the subconvexity problem is. As I promised earlier, here is the end goal, the Lindelof hypothesis. So basically, we actually want to get the constant 1/4 or 1/2, if you consider 1 minus sigma, to be a big zero, right? So the importance of this Lindelof hypothesis comes from the fact that this concerns the behavior of the Riemann zeta function itself. But also it is important because the Riemann hypothesis implies the Lindelof hypothesis. So by counterpositivity, if the Lindelof hypothesis is false, then automatically the Riemann hypothesis is also false. And as a believer of the Riemann hypothesis, I strongly hope that this is true. And the data shown in this graph also seems to support it, which is a good thing. So a lot is already known, and we're slowly getting to the goal on the Riemann zeta function. Now people want to see some other scenario. So people have considered other L functions. For example, people have thought about the similar problems with the Dirichlet series in the Selberg class. The Selberg class is a collection of certain multiple certain Dirichlet series that share many of the nice properties with the Riemann zeta function. For example, they have Euler product over prime numbers. They have functional equations involving the gamma factors, just like Riemann zeta function. And also each of the Dirichlet series in the Selberg class has the convexity bound that is analogous to the one of the Riemann zeta function. So this Selberg class was a natural next step for people to dig into. And in this context, the subconvexity problem basically asks for a bound which improves on the appropriate analog of the convexity bound, especially when the real part of S is 1/2. All right, so here is one of the known results on the Felbert class, which is called the weak subconvexity. In 2010, Soundararajan proved the weak subconvexity of the Dirichlet series in the Felbert class. Well, the weak subconvexity problem doesn't really solve the subconvexity problem, since it only saves the logarithmic power rather than a power of analytic conductor. But in the paper, he also mentions that in some applications, it appears that some weak subconvexity bound would suffice in the place of genuine subconvexity. And he gives an example of a conjecture of Rundini and Sarnak on the masses equidistribution of the Hecke eigenforms. For that, they could combine the sieve estimates for the shifted convolution problem developed by Holowinski and weak subconvexity given here, and then they could solve it. Unfortunately, in this setting, the full subconvexity problem is still open. Okay, so I gathered some other results on subconvexity in various different settings. So these are for the GL2 cases. Duke, Friedlander, and Ivaniak proved that for a primitive cuspidal mass waveform with Laplace eigenvalue 1/4 plus TF squared, then my L function is bounded by this. So, and then Mitchell and Venkatesh also proved that for all pi in GL1 or GL2 over a number field, there exists some delta such that this is true. So this is another subconvexity estimate. Later, Han Wu specified this delta to be less than 1/1889. Okay, so these are some results beyond the GL2, mostly in SL3. So in 2011, Xiaoqing Li showed this subconvexity, adapting the idea of Duke Friedlander and Ivaniak's moments and amplification techniques. And then Blummer proved this one. And Manushi proved these two in around 2015. To prove this, Manushi used Duke Friedlander and Ivaniak's delta symbol method, Voronoi summation, and Cauchy-Schwarz. And then a couple of years later, Holowinski and Nelson improved this result. And to prove this, they did not use the DFI's delta symbol, which uses Peterson trace formula, but instead they used general trace formula given by Kowalski, Lin, Mitchell, and Salen. Okay, so then the next question to ask is, what else? And we focused on the Shintani Zeta function. To talk about the subconvexity of Shintani Zeta function, we need to know what they are first. So the Shintani Zeta function is a Zeta function associated to the prehomogeneous vector spaces. Then we need to know what the prehomogeneous vector space is, right? So the prehomogeneous vector space is usually denoted by this triple. V stands for the finite dimensional vector space. G is a subgroup of general linear GLV, basically. And then rho is an action, and under this action rho, G has open dense orbit in V. All right, so a prehomogeneous vector space consists of a rational representation of complex algebraic Lie group G, right? And then we have a singular set, which consists of the point elements in V, which has the discriminant zero. And aside from the singular set S, there are G orbits. Okay, so the analytic study of zeta functions over the prehomogeneous vector space has a rich history. So in 1960s, Sato and Kimura completely classified the prehomogeneous vector space. And in 1970s, Sato and Shintani studied the analytic properties of a single variable zeta functions, like finding metamorphic continuation and functional equations. Then in 1990s, Datkovsky, Wright, and Yukie did similar work in idyllic setting and made some conjectures of the similar nature regarding the number fields. More recently, Blummer, Chintahoff, Taniguchi, and Thorne, among others, have been working in this field actively, and they classified the local orbits and their exponential sums and found subconvexity of zeta functions in critical strip in a number of different prehomogeneous vector spaces. So before jumping into the main result, I would like to make a storyline where these work come into a picture. So in 1971, the famous Davenport and Heilbron counted the number of cubic fields ordered by the discriminant. So for the positive discriminant ones, the number grows like 1/12 zeta 3x. And for the negative discriminant ones, the number grows like 1/4 zeta of 3 times x. Well, this is amazing and great and all that, but this amazing result have some critical limitations as well. That the numerical data did not really agree with this result quite well, even if we consider the cubic fields of discriminant as large as 10^7. So this problem led people to ask how to better manage the error terms or even to determine the precise second order term. So fast forward 4 years, Belabas, Bargava, and Pomerance improved the error term to the big O of 7, we go up x to the power 7/8. And in a couple more years, Bargava, Shankar, and Zimmerman found the precise second order term, which is this, right? And with the power of 5/6. The upshot is that these results agree extremely well with the numerical data. They use a lot of geometry to prove this, and their work is amazing. Well, then another paper was published around the same time by Taniguchi and Thorne, which also finds the precise second order term, but with even better magnitude of the error term. And their work uses Shintani's method, using like Tauberian type theorems and stuff. Okay, so then how is Shintani's method related to counting cubic fields? Like, how is Shintani zeta function related to counting cubic fields? The answer comes from yet another famous Delaunay, Fadiv, Gangor-Savin correspondence, which says that the cubic rings are in discriminant preserving bijective correspondence with the integral binary cubic forms up to GL2Z equivalence class. And this correspondence is very explicit and it can be written in these three short lines. And the space of binary cubic forms is in fact a pre-homogeneous vector spaces. So use Shintani's theta function is a theta function over a pre-homogeneous vector space. So we see the connection here. So let's take a deeper look into this pre-homogeneous vector space of binary cubic forms. So we're going to let V sub R as a space of real binary cubic forms with the standard element of F as general AX cubed plus BX squared Y plus CXY squared plus DY cubed with all the coefficients A, B, C, D in the real numbers. And obviously the integral forms will have the coefficients integers. Then the discriminant of this standard element is b squared c squared minus 4ac cubed minus 4b cubed d minus 27a squared d squared plus 18abcd. Then there is a left GL2 action, which is given here. It's the general, the usual GL2 action we usually get, right? Then we have a singular set, which with the elements of discriminant zero. And aside from that, we have either discriminant positive or negative, and these form two dense open orbits. So finally, we can carefully define the Shintani Zeta functions associated to the space of binary cubic forms. We're going to write it as C to not be confused with the Riemann Zeta function, Zeta, right? So this C plus or minus of S is summation over all the forms in VZ mod by SL2Z, one over the stabilize the size of the stabilizer, and then discriminant of F to the power of negative S. Well, this VZ is the lattice of integral binary cubic forms, and the stabilizer is an abelian group of order one or three. In the next slide, I'll tell you what the stabilizer is. Okay, so if we translate the definition of the Shintani Zeta function into the language of the cubic rings, then we get this, right? One over the size of the automorphic ring, one over the discriminant of R to the power S. And this is the direct application of the Delaunay Faddeev correspondence. And now we are going to choose the base points F plus and F minus. The reason why we choose these points over everything else is because these will give the nicest stabilizer to work with. So the stabilizer of F minus is trivial group, and the stabilizer of F plus is the rotation group generated by the rotation by 2π/3. So we see the group of abelian group of order one, abelian group of order three. Okay, so then what are some good traits and the bad traits of the Shintani Zeta function? One of the good features is that it has functional equation, and it is related to the class number. So we can probably use Cohen-Lenstra heuristics and stuff. However, unlike the Riemann Zeta function, it cannot be expressed as an Euler product or even a finite sum of Euler products. And it is known that it does not satisfy the Riemann hypothesis. Remember how how I said, the Lindelof hypothesis is an end goal of the subconvexity problem. And it is a consequence of Riemann zeta function. Riemann hypothesis, right? It'll be super cool to show that although the Riemann hypothesis is not satisfied, we can still prove something that is analogous to the Lindelof hypothesis. Okay, so I just said that one of the good traits is to have a functional equation. So just to show you the functional equation of the Shintani zeta function, here it is. It's due to the original Shintani from 1972. So it's not like one line functional equation, pretty like, you know, but these two phi functions satisfy this matrix form functional equation relating this C plus or minus with the dual of them. In addition, also, he explicitly computes the poles and residues of these C plus or minus and their duals as well. Okay, so that's going to be the introduction part, I guess. And then now I'm going to move on to my own result. So now we're ready to introduce the main result. We start by introducing the diagonalization of this C functions, C add and C sub by square root of 3 times C plus or minus C minus. So then this is the theorem Bob and I proved, that these diagonalized Shintani zeta function satisfy the subconvex bound of tau to the power of 98 over 99. And the twisted Shintani zeta function satisfy the subconvex bound of tau to the power 26 over 27. Well, I didn't carefully define the twisted ones, since we'll focus on this part for tonight.
What is the convexity bound for the Shintani?
So the convexity bound is 1.
I'm listening to something.
Did my Amazon package come?
I don't know. He's being groomed.
Okay. So yes. So I'm going to talk about the convexity bound very briefly in the next slide, but yeah, the convexity bound is 1, so we're saving 1 over 99. So this is basically the mass cost form. And another thing to note is that the functional equation for these are not known.
Wait, is your second bound for a Mas cusp form or for a Shintani zeta function?
So this is the twisted Shintani zeta function, which is twisted by the Mas cusp
form. Oh, twisted by a Mas form.
Yes. Okay, so here's a little more discussion on the main result. The convexity bound in this case is just like I said, it is 1. So our result saves the power by 1 over 99. And this result gives the highest degree example of a zeta function subconvex in the T aspect. So I should also mention that the method we introduce here is general, and we expect to find the subconvexity for zeta functions over general prehomogeneous vector spaces. For now, we're working on the Corti case, and as soon as it's finished, we'll try to generalize in full. In case anyone's wondering, the case of the space of binary quadratic forms is done by Valentin Blommer. Okay, so from now on, I'll try to sketch the proof of theorem for the rest of the time. The basic outline is laid out here. We first introduce the approximate functional equation. Then I'm going to use the Bhargava's averaging technique. Then we are going to take care of the cusp forms. Then using the Van der Kolk inequality twice and Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, we finish the proof. So let me first introduce the approximate functional equation. So Ivanek and Kowalski outlined the framework of this approximate functional equation, representing zeta functions with a functional equation inside the critical strip. So the inside the domain of absolute convergence, we can write this phi functions as a Dirichlet series. And these a add and a sub will contain some special data, including explicit gamma factor conductor, analytic conductor, and functional equation, and completed zeta function. So, so this analytic conductor, let me actually try to write some of them out. So this is the conductor times the product over j equals 1 to d. S plus KJ plus 3. And then completed zeta function is Q epsilon over 2, gamma of S, C of S. And in our case, my D is 4, epsilon is 1, and the conductor is 432. All right, so having these, well, I'm going to give you the gamma factors in the next slide. All right, so in 2004, Ivanek and Kowalski proved this theorem. So here, this G is the test function. This is a test function. And so basically it has to be a holomorphic, even, and at zero, it has to be one and bounded where the real part of U is less than 4. And so if we choose the test function to be cosine of pi u over 4a to the power of negative 4dA. We're going to choose the test function to be this. And using the Stirling's approximation, this residue terms will approach it to a little over 1 as t approaches to infinity. This is Stirling's approximation. And then these epsilon values, the absolute value of this epsilon has to be 1. And these are the gamma factors I was talking about. So this gamma add or sub, right? This is going to be pi to negative d, gamma s over 2, gamma s plus 1 over 2, gamma s plus 1/2 plus or minus 1/3 over 2, and then s plus 1/2 plus or minus 2/3 over 2. So whatever they are, so these are explicit gamma factors, right? Yeah, so then our using this theorem, the main theorem we want to prove reduces to study these summations basically, right? Because they are, we don't have to care about them. These are just ones. So these are the ones we need to study. So proving the main result comes down to proving these propositions. So these two statements. Okay, so then let's try to prove this. First, we're going to use the Bhargava's averaging technique to get this. So using the average technique, we get from here, we're going to use the averaging technique from here, okay? So then this averaging technique of Bhargava is a way of counting lattice points by averaging on the various fundamental domains. This is useful for bounding the number of points appearing in the cusps. If you want to learn a little more about this, please refer to a paper by Bhargava, Shankar, and Zimmerman from 2013. And you know, that's the same paper they find the second order term of the Davenport and Hebron. Back to our discussion. So we get this expression right here. Then this second part, so simply put, is here to bound this F into the domain of a fundamental domain. And this sigma, the sigma is a smooth partition of unity. Which is in CC infinity. And sigma has to be greater than or equal to zero. And because this is the partition of unity, sigma of x over 2n, if I sum it over for x greater than or equal to 1, it has to be 1. This is used to control the size of the discriminant. This is another partition of a smooth partition of unity on SL2R, which is supported on a Siegel set, and it's K invariant, and if you sum over F of gamma G, it has to be 1. Well, this is a specific integral, VZ, WV dV over the discriminant of V. And What else? This H is the maximal subset of G plus. Okay, so
I have a question about the function V, capital V.
Capital V?
V. This V of a half, yes. I mean, it should have some decay property as tau goes to infinity, right?
Yes, so this V is
How does V depend on tau? It should decay, right?
It does decay, yes.
I mean, does it count the elements up to the square root of tau or something like that?
Does it count as square root of tau?
Okay. I mean, you have a sum over n, so the V function, if it's an approximate functional equation, should cut down on the number of n's. I mean, I would think. You know.
I think so, but I can't be sure right now. Can I maybe talk to you after?
Okay.
Okay, so let me move on. So what we're going to do is to take care of the cusp by truncating in T. Okay, so we're going to set the parameters first. T1 and T2. Then the number of forms with A non-zero and T greater than T1 is basically the big O of Y over T1 plus Y to the power 5 over 6. And the number of forms with A being zero and T less than T2 is big O of Y to the power 3/4 times T2. And these values come from the bounding the points in the cusp. So combining the error terms becomes this. So, so other than these forms, I'm going to sum over the where A equals not zero and T less than or equal to T. And I'm going to call it sigma one and sigma two to be the sum over A equal to zero and T greater than or equal to T2. And we're going to look at this sigma one and sigma two. Okay, so we analyze this sigma one by introducing a space average. So we're going to introduce two averaged sums. So first one is sigma one prime, and the average happens here for this, for all these, right? So this B sub R is basically the ball of the the radius R. So this is Y in BZ such that the magnitude is less than or equal to R. And this R is just the parameter, right? RY is a parameter, which is less than or bounded by Y to the power 1/4 over T1 cubed. Okay, then in this case, this discriminant is asymptotic to the discriminant of F. And so what we get is because these, then what we get is the difference of this sigma one and sigma one prime is explained like this, because of the forms where there these two differ have the discriminant F asymptotic to Y and TF is asymptotic to T1 as well. Okay, so then we introduce another average sum, sigma one double prime. And sigma one double prime averages here, right? And then using the derivative bound, the difference between sigma one and sigma two is bounded by this value. And we choose the right R, and we choose this R from the bound of this thing. So from the bounds of this thing, we get this R. That's gonna be the optimal one. And then the magnitude of sigma one double prime is bounded by this. All right, so we have the size of sigma one double prime, the difference between sigma one prime and sigma one double prime, and the size of sigma, the difference between sigma one and sigma one prime. So collecting everything, we can say that sigma one is, we can get this form. Okay, and then we're going to choose optimally this T1, the parameter T1 to be minimum of Y to the power 1/24 and tau to the power of 1/99. And then we sum over Y equals to 2N. Then we get sigma one equals big O of tau to the power 98/99. Okay, so then we're going to move on to sigma 2. It's kind of similar to what we did for sigma 1. So here we take r to be little o of y to the power 1/4, t to cubed, and then we write fd as f plus 0, 0, 0, d. And in this case, if the size of d is bounded by r, that means the discriminant of fd is going to be asymptotic to the discriminant of f because of the some partial derivatives, dt over dd and d lambda over dd. Okay, so then we define this average sum, which happens, average happens here. Well, this this W is basically, I'm kind of getting lazy. This is the second line, the double integral stuff. Okay, then the difference of sigma 2 prime and sigma 2 is this. And again, because the forms where they differ have Tf asymptotic to T2, and the discriminant of F is asymptotic to Y. Okay, then we, just like before, we take another average sum, sigma to double prime of Y. So it's this. So the average happens only on the discriminant. Right, then by the estimate for the derivative of the weight function with respect to D, the difference between sigma 2 prime and sigma 2 double prime is bounded by this value. And using the estimate for the exponential sums, the size of sigma 2 double prime is bounded by this. Okay, so combine all the results regarding the sigma 2, we can bound the sigma 2 by this. And we choose the T2, the optimal T2 of y to the power 1/4 over t to the power 1/9. And we, so if you just plug it in there, we get this. And if I sum over all the y equals to 2 to the power n, we get our final result for sigma 2, which is bounded by tau to the power 8/9. So sigma 1 was bounded by tau to the power 98/99, and sigma 2 is bounded by tau to the power 8/9. And then the other errors were smaller than that. So this finally prove the main theorem. Okay, so, well, there are heavy computations and a lot of things to go over. I tried my best to stay away from technical details and keep it as simple as possible, but I'm not sure if I actually succeeded in presenting the work understandable. Well, I guess this is it for today. Thanks for listening and have a wonderful rest of your evening.
Well, thank you very much for a very nice talk. Does anyone have any questions? Well, I have a question if no one else does.
Okay.
Are there any applications of your convexity bound, a subconvexity bound?
So, well, subconvexity, I mean, I guess there are a lot of people who are interested in the subconvexity for various reasons, but for me, I mean, I just think it is, it'll be cool to find the subconvexity or the Lindelöf hypothesis in this matter because of, you know, the non-existing Riemann hypothesis, right? So, well, that's my reason for studying this. Maybe Bob has some other agendas, but I'm not sure.
But there must be some applications to cubic forms and stuff like
that. Yeah. But I mean, as long as we set up the equation, really the properties of the cubic form doesn't really appear anywhere. So maybe, maybe not, I don't know.
Are there any other questions? Okay, I'd like to thank you again for a talk. And thank I'm gonna you. Now turn off the recording.
All right, awesome. Brian, I'll... Oh, I just wanted